You're listening to the audio production of Christian, Audio Bible Studies, by Andy Stanley, published by Harper Christian Resources. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Christian includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambience of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching. While not required for the audio experience, these studies are designed to partner with the coordinating study guide sold separately.
When you look into the New Testament, the Gospels, and the book of Acts specifically, there is a term that's used very, 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 very consistently to describe these people that were a part of this Jesus movement. It's a terrifying term. It's the term disciple. And the reason this is a terrifying term, it should disturb you, is because it is so clearly defined. You can hide behind Christianity all day long. You can go to war in the name of Christianity. You can do all kinds of things in the name of Christianity. You can define it, redefine it, misdefine it, undefine it. You can do all kinds of stuff with Christian. But I'm telling you, you lock into this word, open your New Testament, and oh my goodness. Few examples. The one we just looked at from Acts chapter 11, remember this? The disciples, think about the significance of this verse now. The disciples were called Christians. If you would ask the followers of Jesus, what are you? They would have said, they wouldn't have said Christian, they would have said what? I'm a disciple. I'm a disciple. But the disciples who called themselves disciples were first called Christians. Now, from this point forward, look throughout the New Testament, you're going to see this word over and over and over. Now, what is a disciple? Well, the English word disciple means the same thing as the Greek word disciple, methetos. It simply means a learner, a pupil, an apprentice, an adherent, and a follower. A disciple is a person that does this. I'm trying to make a decision. How would you handle this? That's how I'll handle it. Oh, I'm trying to decide how to respond to a situation. How would you respond to that situation? Oh, that's how I'll respond to that situation. What would you do if you were me? Then that's what I'm going to do. Where are you going? Then that's where I'm going to go. How would you react to this? How do you live your life? How do you manage relationships? Oh, then that's how I'll live my life. That's how I'll manage my relationships. A disciple is a person that's looking to someone to say, give me direction, show me how to live my life. And the answer, before you even give me the answer, I want you to know the answer is yes. 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 Now, what is it you think I should do? Woo! See, that's different than Christian, isn't it? Christian. Disciple. In fact, the word disciple is uncomfortable. In fact, you're hoping at the end of this message, I'm not going to say, which I'm not. So I'm not going to say, so from now on, we're not going to use the word Christian anymore. We're going to tell people we're disciples. You're going to be like, I can't do that. That's just weird. I mean, but that's my point. See, it's kind of hard to dodge the word and misdefine and redefine. Disciple. Here's some other examples. Just again, you find them throughout the New Testament. So the word of God spread and the number of, not Christians, and the number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly. And then here's one about the Apostle Paul. This is pretty interesting. When he came to Jerusalem, Paul, and I remember Paul persecuted the church. He put people in prison. He was trying to get rid of the church, and then he became a follower of Jesus. And so the people who were followers of Jesus, they didn't trust him because they think, oh, you're just trying to infiltrate and, you know, be an insider so you can have us all arrested. So he decides to try to join the church. When he, Paul, came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples. And he thought that was a band. No, this was actually what they called the people who followed Jesus. And this isn't the 12 disciples. That's the apostles. This is just the general group of people who followed Jesus. So the apostle Paul tries to join the disciples, not Christians. They didn't use that term. But they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was really a disciple. That's how they described themselves. And then here's cool. There was actually disciplettes. So this is just women. You need to know this, okay? Check this out. In Joppa, there was a disciple or disciplette named Tabitha. So even women could be disciples. It's awesome. She was always doing good and helping the poor. So the point so far in this series is we can hide behind the word Christian, but if you look into the New Testament and ask the question, what were these people really about and how did they describe themselves? They referred to themselves and to each other as disciples, which brings us to this terrifying, disturbing question. And it's this: are we disciples? Or are we just Christians? Are you a disciple of Jesus? Or are you just a Christian? Are you a follower of Jesus? Is your answer yes, Jesus? Doesn't matter what the question is, it's yes. Or are you a Christian? See, that's just disturbing, isn't it? So what I want to do is we kind of close in on our first session of this today. Hopefully you'll come back next week. Is I want to now take you to a moment in time with Jesus where he speaks directly to people who want to be disciples. And he gives them kind of the, okay, if you're going to be a disciple, not just a Christian, here's the bottom line. If you don't hear anything else I say, do anything else I do, here are your specific marching orders. And I'm telling you, as you're going to see, and this isn't new information. If you grew up in church, what I'm about to read, you have read or heard 1,000 times. This isn't like, well, I didn't know that was in there. It's not one of those verses. But I'm telling you, if we had have gotten this right, if the, quote, Christians had decided, forget Christian, I'm going to be a disciple. If we had just gotten what I'm about to read, just this one element of Jesus' teaching, just this one facet of Jesus' teaching, if we just got this one part of being a disciple right, there may not have been any First World War. There definitely would not have been a Second World War. There would have been no civil war in this country. Slavery would have been put to rest long before. And there would have been no need for a civil rights movement in this nation. If the followers of Jesus had actually followed not 10 commandments, not the whole New Testament, not everything the Apostle Paul teaching, if we had just gotten this one teaching of Jesus right, our world and our nation in particular would be a different and better place. So here's what happens. Jesus is at the end of his ministry. And he's in this, he's about to have the last Passover with his Jewish followers, you know, the apostles. Judas has already left to go betray him. So Jesus realizes, I'm running out of time, and there's just a couple things I got to tell these guys before I'm crucified and exit this planet. And so if you've got kids, okay, kids, remember, dad, there's three. Okay, your mom said there's four. Okay, there's five things. Don't ever forget these six things. You know, it's like, here's those lessons before your kids leave. It's like, oh, I'm sure I forgot something. So Jesus is like, okay, here it is. Here's the one thing you got to get right. Here's what he said. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. In other words, lean in. We're running out of time. You will look for me. And just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now where I'm going, you cannot come. Now, when he says you cannot come, Peter, who's sitting there, he perks up. It's like, what do you mean we can't come? We're going in. Wherever you go, we go. We're disciples. You can't. What do you mean you're going to go somewhere we can't go? Okay, is Andrew going to get to go? Because if Andrew's going, I'm going. You're not like just leaving me out, are you? Okay. So Peter, he's just obsessed with, you're going somewhere. You're going somewhere. We can't go. I want to go. You sure we can't go? Then Jesus moves on and he says this. A new commandment I give you. A new commandment, the little Greek word new can mean unusual, strange, odd, impractical, you never thought of this before, a new commandment I give you. And the thing is, most of you know what's coming, and it wasn't really that new on the surface. Okay, guys, lean in. You know, you're my guys. We had 12, now we're down to 11, so let's do this quick before we're down to fewer, okay? A new commandment I give you. Ready? Love one another. Love one another. And John's like, okay, that's not new. I mean, that's in the Old Testament. We've even heard you say this before. Love one another. A new commandment I give you. Love one another. Then he elaborates. He says this. As I have loved you, as I have loved you, so you must love one another. Matthew, you remember when we met, Matthew? You remember what you were doing? Tax collector. I know. You were a traitor. Everybody hated you, Matthew. Peter, you remember the day we met Matthew? Remember how you guys didn't even want to talk to Matthew because he's a traitor, he's a tax collector? Mm-hmm. Remember where we went after we met Matthew? John, remember where we went? Yeah, went to Matthew's house. Yeah, remember who's there? Mm-hmm. All those people that we weren't supposed to hang around with. My mama said, don't hang around with those kind of people. And you took us to a party full of those kind of people. And remember the conflict between all you guys and Matthew? Remember how we managed that? Remember how I loved Matthew? Now, that's what I want you guys to do. I want you to love each other that way. Nathaniel, remember what the first day we met? You remember. In fact, the rest of you guys, you don't know about this deal with Nathaniel, okay? His brother's here, eyewitness, went to get Nathaniel and said, Nathaniel, I've met the Messiah. You got to come meet this guy. He's from Nazareth. And Nathaniel, you remember what you said? And Nathaniel's hanging his head. He's going, Jesus said, Nathaniel said, could anything good come from Nazareth? You dissed my entire family, Nathaniel. And do you remember how I treated you? I said, come on, follow me. Be one of my guys. That's how I want you to love each other. Okay, guys, you remember the day that I did like the vampire sermon where I talked about drink my blood and eat my body and it was just so weird and people are getting up and leaving and everybody's abandoning us. You remember that day? Every single one of you wanted to leave me. Come on, guys, look at me. Every single one of you wanted to get up, fade into the crowd and be done with me, and I knew it. You remember that day? You remember how I treated you? Remember how I accepted you? Remember how I forgave you even though you were about to betray me? Okay, I want you to love one another. That's what I want to characterize your relationship with each other. And then he said this, by this one relational breakthrough, will everyone know that you are my, what's the next word? Disciples. There it is. See, Christian, we can all be Christians. Love each other the way that Jesus loved those guys. Now I'm like in a subset, aren't I? Now I'm like in a much smaller category. I don't know how to get around that. I don't know how to defend that. I don't know how to exegete my way away from that. By this one thing, everyone will know you're my disciples. And then in just in case they missed it, if you love one another. So I know you're all Christians. Are you a disciple? Now, here's my favorite part of the passage. Okay, Jesus is just, I mean, this is like big. This is like, okay, it's not how much you know. It's not where you go to synagogue on Saturday. It's not, you know, all that stuff. The one thing, the litmus test, the bottom line, the defining characteristic of the people that follow me are not going to be how much they even know about me or how loud they sing or how long they pray. It's going to be all about if they love one another. I mean, this is a big deal. And Peter raises his hand. Yeah, Peter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.